Okay, all right, that's good. All right, this morning we have a particular theme, and that is around the closure of institutions. This has been a very big part of Valid's work for the last 25 years, lobbying and advocating for the closure of institutions to support people to have good lives in the community. It's not just happening in Victoria, it's happening all around Australia, the closure of institutions and the supporting of community living. This morning, we've got two presentations from two groups of people who are on that journey, moving out of institutional life into community life. The first presentation is going to be from a group of people from Stockton, just outside of Newcastle in New South Wales. And I'd like to welcome up onto the stage representatives of the local advocacy group that involves and supports people from Stockton. So Jen, you're coming up, and we need chairs too, guys. Here we go. So I'd like to welcome onto the stage Catherine, Jenny, Robert, and Lee. And we're also going to see a video this morning. So the first presentation will be from people from all the way from Newcastle, New South Wales. And then after this presentation, we'll be hearing from people all the way from Bendigo. Okay. Right, they're slowly making their way up here.
I should have had a joke ready or something.
Come on, Robert. There you go, here comes Robert.
Hi.
How are you?
Good.
Okie doke. How are you, Robert? So we have Robert, Lee, Catherine, and now all we need is a Jen.
And a Sandra.
Sorry, Sandra. Yep. And Jen, you'll need a microphone.
Over to Lee.
Over to Lee, okay. I'll leave you for it.
Thanks, Kevin. Okay.
Mobiles off, please.
Well, good morning, everyone. I'm Kath Marnie, and I'm the coordinator of CEDA, which stands for Community Disability Alliance Hunter. CEDA is run for people with disability by people with disability. And we set up CEDA to help each other with all the changes that came with the NDIS. And Kevin just briefly introduced, but I'd like to introduce my peers and co-presenters who are here with me today. So Lee, morning Lee.
Morning people.
Lee is a peer mentor and peer trainer who took the lead to make a movie interviewing three people from Stockton Centre about their hopes for the future. And we'll watch that movie at the end of our presentation. And two of those people are here with us today. So Robert, hello Robert. And Sandra. Hi, Sandra. And it's been a really exciting couple of days for all of us because both Robert and Sandy flew for the first time yesterday to get here. So that was really exciting. Yep. And both Robert and Sandra are helping CEDA with the best ways that we can work with people at Stockton Centre to speak up. And I'd also like to introduce Jen, who's an ally supporting CEDA to do our work. Hi, Jen. So since CEDA started, our members have wanted to connect with their peers at the large residential centres in the Hunter. We wanted to make sure that everyone in the Hunter could have peer support if they wanted it, and that it had to include people living at Stockton, Tomaree and Canangra centres. It was people with intellectual disability that paved the way and took the idea forward, which was that we would have peer support in the large residential centres. All our peer mentors see it as really important work. So Lee, tell us why you wanted to make a video with people from the Stockton Centre.
Yeah, of course, Kath. It was a dream of mine to make a DVD, but also that I believe on the voices of people with disabilities should have a voice and to raise concerns, and no matter what the issue is, I believe that these are people, and we just want to share what's been happening at the Stockton Centre, but also that these amazing people, Sandy and Robert, are just amazing, and it was good to work with them. And while we, and also on the speaking up and self, between self-advocacy and speaking up, that's most important.
Yeah. And Lee, you and I know as people with disability that the community isn't always welcoming to people with disability. And so you also made the movie to help the broader community be more welcoming, people with disability.
Yeah, I think in the community that they need to be out there doing like any normal person would do. If it's going to the shops and shopping, going to the movies and be with their friends, and it's most important to be out in the community, to do absolutely everything there is to do in the community. And these lovely people who are up on here tell you guys what they want to do.
Yeah.
Just amazing what people with disabilities can do.
And it was also really important to us that we heard the voices of people with intellectual disability, because we know that often people with intellectual disability don't get to have their voice heard and tell their story. So that was really important to you too, Lee, wasn't it?
It was. Sometimes it's hard to get their voices out there, but with me as a peer mentor, but other peer mentors with CEDA are helping the people from the Stockton Centre to speak up more, and that's what we need.
And speaking of peer mentors, your greatest peer mentor is Robert Strike. And I know Robert's here. I'm not sure if he's in the room, but yes. But, yep. Give Robert a clap. For those of you who haven't caught up on the exciting news, Robert was recently awarded an Order of Australian Merit. Yay. Give him another clap. And Lee, you interview Robert in the film.
Yes.
Why is peer mentoring important?
Peer mentoring is most important to connect with people with disabilities. We need to connect, and that's most important. We need to support people with disabilities, but we need to really know what every person with a disability wants to do, or to do things that they normally do. So. I don't look at people's disabilities, I look at people's abilities, and that they will shine through lots of journeys that they will go through.
Yep, and you and Robert certainly make that clear in the film, so we'll have a watch of that soon. I think we've talked about it's important that a peer mentor has really, as your girlfriend likes to say, has really walked a mile in our shoes, so there is that sense of having really shared understanding of life. So, and Lee, now as part of our peer-to-peer work, we've started Speak Up training with people and staff from the Stockton Centre and people moving into their new homes.
Yes.
And we've been doing this work with the New South Wales Ombudsman, and you're part of that training, Lee. And we also use the fantastic short movies made by Valid, which talk to us about how we can speak up about abuse and neglect.
Of course.
So thanks to Valid for that.
Of course, I've been working for the Ombudsman for a few weeks, and doing the same sort of thing that the Valid's doing, but I'm doing with the Ombudsman, and that's travelling around from country to country. Doing lots of stuff with Christine.
Yep. So we're really thrilled to have some exciting partnerships happening. So in the next 3 months, Lee, we'll be meeting about 40 people as they move into their new homes. And we really like the fact that the training is run by people with disability, like all our work at CEDA. So Lee, why is it important that people with disability actually run the training, do the training?
I think it's most important that people should run the training, especially people with disabilities, because they can walk a mile in their shoes, that they've been there. As for me, I've been there myself, I know how it feels. As for other people, it is really important to make that connection at the Stockton Centre, but make connections everywhere. In at the Canoundra and the one at...
Yep, you've done some work in some other large residential centres.
I've done some work in other large residential centres and just amazing to work with these lovely people. They're amazing.
And we also want people, I think we've talked about the fact that we really want to show that people with disability can be leaders. We can do the training, and we also think it's important, don't we, Lee, that for the staff, because the staff do the training with the people that they're working with, and so we think it's really important that they get to think about the experience, the point of view of people with disability. As Lee says in the movie, there's nothing that can't be achieved, and connections have been made between peers, and they're already making a difference, and we're looking forward to even more connections in the coming years. Sandy, you're part of Lee's film. We're not going to see you in the film today because we have the great opportunity to ask you some questions in person. So I'll hand over to you and Jen now, and you can tell us a little bit about yourself.
Sandy, there's going to be a lot of people that want to meet you and communicate with you at the conference. Lots of fantastic people to meet. So let's show people the best way to communicate with you. Can you show us how you say no? So you look away and turn your head the other way. And how do you say yes? It's when you turn your head and look at the person in the eyes. And so, Sandy, you were involved with the movie with Lee. Did you like being involved in that movie? Yeah. And you came to the Council for Intellectual Disability conference last year to launch the movie. Did you enjoy that conference? Got to meet a lot of people? So it's really important to be able to speak up and have your say. And these conferences are great to help us to be able to do that. So this conference is about, it's about choice and it's about change. And you've got a really big change coming up. You've been living at Stockton for 40 years, is that right? Around 40 years. And you've made lots of connections with staff at Stockton, including Vicky and Trevor, who have travelled with you for this trip down to Geelong. And
thanks.
Including Chad, you went to Chad's wedding. Love Chad. And we know that you're feeling a bit anxious about some of the moves that are the changes that are happening. Or maybe you're also excited about some of the changes that are happening. And one thing that we do know is that you're excited about moving out with your best friend who you've been living with for a long time. You do everything together. Paint the town red together, and you're moving out with her. So that's exciting. So thanks, Sandy. We're really thrilled that you've come with us down to Geelong and helping us doing our work at Stockton. And Robert, can I...
Yeah.
Can I chat with you now, Robert? We'll see more of you in the film later on, but what we do know, Robert, is that you do really like to be part of the action. The lights are very bright up here on the stage, so I just... it's quite bright. So how about I come back here? You like to be part of the action, but one thing that we do know about what you want with your move is that you want to move really close to your mum. Is that right? And one thing that's really important for you is that you're near public transport so you can catch a train to see your mum and be as independent as possible with that, yeah? And you've already organised to meet your mum at the coffee shop that's near the house that you're moving into and work out ways that you can do that independently once you move. So that's all happening. So we'll see a bit more of you in the film. So let's check it out.
Thanks, Robert and Sandy. And Jen. We also meet, I'll stop talking and we'll show you the film in a sec. We also meet Stephen in the film. He can't be with us today, but he really hopes to make it to the Ballad Conference next year. So we'll finish our presentation with a few snippets. It's not the whole thing, but it's a few snippets of the film Stockton, A Time of Change, starring Lee, Sandy, Stephen, Robert King and Robert Strike.
Well, my name is Lee Crichton. I'm 37 years old and I have Down syndrome. And part of my role, I'm a peer mentor. I do peer-to-peer support work with people we support from day to day. I'm also looking forward to do some peer-to-peer support in at the Stockton Residential Centre and basically talking to them, see what they like to do and get those goals happening for them.
What do you know about the planned closure of the large residential centres?
What I do know, there's large residential centres are closing down all around, not just all around Newcastle, but all around the States. So I set a goal, I set a dream for myself is to take on my local area, then take on the state, then take on the world, and closing all at large residential centres.
Okay, so this is Stephen Harrison and lives at Stockton Centre, Unit 6. He's 42 years old and is a lover of football and soccer. And is a bit of a movie buff.
How long have you been at the Stockton Centre?
35 years.
Do you like living here at the Stockton Centre?
Yes and no.
So I just want to talk about the last residential centres and what do you know about the last residential centres?
I think the residential centres, or the institution I call them, they should be closed down.
Yeah, definitely.
But we need places like the community to accept us as people, not as disabled. Because because people with disability can do things if you show them.
Definitely. So I look at people's abilities and not their disabilities.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's what I look at.
Yeah. Can you imagine yourself living in a group home or your own flat? Is that something you would like?
Yes.
Are you looking forward to moving?
Yes.
Do you have any fears about moving to a new place?
No.
So what do you think about the self-confidence will improve of when they do move out in the community and they live in the community?
I think they will improve because they're changing their life and getting to live individually or in a group home together. And I think if they can close all the institution down, then the clients or the people who live in those institutions will have a better life, I reckon, out in the community. I do like the idea of people moving out in the community to better their skills and better their life.
Yeah.
It's improving their life, actually.
Yeah. It is, it is.
Like seeing people grow.
Yeah.
Much better.
Yeah, the way I look at things, that they might get out in the community, they might have a cup of coffee or something with their support worker. But at the end of the day, they come back to that residential centre.
Mm-hmm.
I want them to be able to be in the community and living in the community just like you have. What do you know about the Stockton Centre closing? How does it make you feel?
You know about Stockton closing, yes? Does it make you sad?
No.
It makes you happy? Yeah, just happy about Stockton Centre closing.
Have you ever been to a group home or a respite centre? What was it like?
You ever been to a group home, mate? Yeah. So you wouldn't know, so it's just resided at Stockton, is that correct? Yeah.
Do you have any fears about moving to a new place?
Your fear? Yep. I think
mum.
His mum's obviously a little bit elderly now, and what would be his...
He wants to live nearer.
Right, yeah, he wants to live nearer. Is the place where he's going near?
Yes.
So that's a bonus. You happy about that? Yeah.
Got a place set out for him to live?
He has actually. He's been out to see the block of land where he's going, and that's in, where was that, sorry? Katara, that's right. Yeah.
Katara, that's right. I just live not far from
Katara. Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
I would like them to live a normal life like I have.
Yeah.
I think it's important to show parents that if I can do it, they can do it.
Yeah.
And work with that, and work with them.
Yeah.
And work with the staff to improve people's lives. That's what we're about.
Yeah.
Improving people's lives in the community.
What would you like your new place to be like? A house? A flat?
Well, should we just sum it up in one hit and just say bachelor pad? Right? Bachelor pad, easy access, get around the place easy. We want, look, I don't even know if we can say half it on camera, to be honest, but it's going to be a party house, and Bob's going to enjoy the rest of his days, wouldn't you? No? What do you reckon about? Is that near mum? Yeah. And we'll have cameras out the front to show us when mum's coming, so we can pack all the beer and stuff away before she gets here. Is that right? Yeah. Have a laugh, sister.
Take a bow.
What do you think about that, folks? Fantastic. Fantastic. Yeah, encore. That was fantastic, guys. Thank you very much. So, as they're leaving the stage, thank you to the people from Newcastle. And I'm sure you'll see them around the conference over the next couple of days. Make sure you go up and congratulate them on the amazing journey that they're on.
Thank you.
We're bringing up people now from Sandhurst. Who said what? Oh, Robert, we're going to leave you there, mate. Did you bring your own beer or what? Over this way, Rob. That's all right. While we're waiting for the people from Sandhurst to come onto the stage, they might be a bit shy. While we're doing that, let me just take the opportunity. I've got a good friend whose name's Jackie Pierce, and she works tirelessly to liberate people who are living in nursing homes prematurely. They shouldn't be in nursing homes. And she wanted me just to remember that when we're talking about the closure of institutions and supporting people to live in the community, Australia still has around 6,200 people with disabilities who are living in nursing homes well before their time for retirement is due. And it's a totally unjust situation. So when we're thinking about these problems, we need to think really big about what we need to do to liberate people. Hi, Ben. Ben and Terry and Mark from Bendigo, who have been on an amazing journey. There we go. Do you have Sarah with you? And Jen? All right, you haven't locked them in a cupboard or something. How you going, mate? Good to see you. Yeah, good to see you. Yeah, good to see you too. As we're coming to the stage, just put some chairs up here. I'll never forget the first time I met these guys, going back about 6 years ago. We met talking at the institution one night, and I asked them, what's the biggest problem you got at this place? One of the biggest problems that they had at that time was that they couldn't get a drink of water after 8 o'clock. So even on a hot day like this, everything was locked up. They had no opportunity to get a cup of tea, a cup of coffee, or a glass of water in that institution. A lot's changed in the last 5 or 6 years, and I'd like to introduce you to Jen Fitt, ex-staff member at Sandhurst, which is just outside of Bendigo.
Thank you. What I want to talk about, and we don't have a lot of time, and I want these guys here to have the opportunity to talk about what it's like living outside of an institution. But I want to give a bit of history on Sandhurst. It's not as old as some of the institutions that have been closing in Victoria, and not as big. So it was built in the 1950s, and it was old army Nissen huts, what people lived in. And in the early 1970s, all the guys, and they're all males, people lived at Sandhurst, they moved to the new buildings, and these buildings were built as hostel accommodation. They weren't really built as long-term accommodation. And in the 80s, we started the closure of the big institutions. And it saw Sandhurst had actually, because of the skill of a lot of the people that were living at Sandhurst, they'd moved out into the community, and the numbers had dropped down to about 30. And then with the closure of Cloola, 18 people moved in and brought the numbers back up to about 48. One of the things about Sandhurst, though, is that it was different from other institutions in that it wasn't built right outside of town on a hill. We didn't have, like, I worked at Cloola, and, you know, doctors would come in. People that were selling clothing would come into the institution. People didn't get to go out to the shops to buy their clothing, to see their own personal doctor, to access general community facilities. Sandhurst was a little bit different in that they always had that relationship with the community. It was smaller and it was closer. But at the end of the day, it was still just an institution. And, you know, we had locked kitchens, and we catered, like with rosters, to more a custodial model, because when you're looking after a larger group of people in one setting, you've got to look out for the majority of people rather than looking to the needs of individuals. So we didn't have rosters that catered to the rhythms of normal daily living with staffing. So. And the other thing is that it was never set up for people as somewhere to make a long-term home. You know, the bedrooms were so tiny, you fit a single bed in, enough area to walk, and built-in cupboards on the side. When we talked about institutional closure, way back in the 90s when I started working at Sandhurst, people said, it's going to close. So we knew it was going to close. It took until, you know, another 20 years before an announcement came. And it's a really important thing to get an announcement about a closure for an institution, because the thing about institutions is when someone lives in an institution, they're classed as already getting services. So it's very hard for them then to actually get on a register or a waiting list or get case management to actually help the person get a support or move out of the institution and into the community. It virtually becomes a life sentence. So the announcement of a closure means that finally the people that lived at the centre And by the time the closure came, we had 29 people still living there. They got their opportunity to be able to plan and move out. But it's more than just making an announcement. One of the things that's really important is about the journey that people go on. We had people living at the centre that the only thing they knew was institutional life. They'd come from Cooloola, a bigger institution, to Sandhurst, a smaller institution. They loved the changes. It was a better life for them, but they hadn't experienced anything else. And so we actually had people that lived at Sandhurst that didn't want to move from Sandhurst, families that didn't want Sandhurst to close. What was really important for Sandhurst before the announcement came was that through Valid and some support from the Office of Professional Practice, they actually had an initiative with the My Rights program and working very closely with Kevin Stone. They went through that program, they learned about their rights, they learned about advocacy, they formed their own advocacy group. So before an announcement was even made, we had people that lived at Sandhurst that had previously said, I don't want to leave Sandhurst, this is my home, saying things like, I want to live in my own home in the community. I don't want to live in an institution. I want to have more say about what I do day to day. I don't want somebody else making all the rules for me. I don't want to fit into this model. I want to determine how my life is lived. And this was really important. So when an announcement came, rather than people saying, oh, I don't want to move, they were saying, can we move tomorrow? They didn't want to wait the 3 years it was going to take for the closure to happen. It's been a long journey, and one of the things that for me as an ex-staff member that's exciting is that I go around and visit people in their new homes, and nobody is unhappy. Everybody is really, really happy. I'm going to wind up a little bit here, but I just want to tell a couple of stories that won't have happened at Sandhurst. One's a really simple one. A mum dropped in, Terry's mum, dropped into their house right at the time they were cooking dinner and they were making Silverside, and she said, can I make the white sauce? It's one of the simplest things in life to do. It never happened in an institution because meals were prepared from a central kitchen. And it wasn't easy access, and people wouldn't have felt comfortable to walk in and say, can I make the white sauce? It's such an important thing, and nothing speaks of home, being home, more than having close family being engaged in your life in that home, and it's just a perfect example about it. Another story I want to tell is one that we're going to see more and more with NDIS. It's something that would never have happened at Sandhurst, and it's happened in one of our houses already. In the house that Sarah lives in, there was a vacancy, and Sarah's gone to her programs, and she's spoken to one of her friends at the program about the vacancy. And this friend also, Shona, lived in a group home. And between Sarah and Shona, they decided that Shona should move into the same house that Sarah lives in. Shona put in a request to be able to be considered to live there. And we said, well, why not? You know, why not Shona get to know the other people that live in the house, and let the people that live in the house make that decision and not be a decision of ours. And since that time, Sarah invited Shona over to meet the other people that lived at the house that she lives at, and Shona's now, they've all said, yes, it would be great having her living there. And so it's friends choosing friends to for the home that they're going to live in. Hopefully we'll see much more of this in an NDIS world. It's something that would never have happened in an institution, and it's just really exciting that that's already happened within 6 months of opening a new home. So, thank you. Did you want to say? So we're going to show a video about the centre and the new homes. And then after that, hopefully some of these guys here would like to get up and say what it's like in their new houses.
Shane, how do you feel now that this might be the last time you see the old centre?
Yeah.
How does that make you feel?
It's a bit sad, isn't it?
Back into the old unit, Terry?
Pretty good at all. It looks pretty empty.
It does, doesn't it?
Yes.
How do you feel about that?
Huh?
How do you feel about that now?
Pretty sad, actually.
Fish?
Oh my God, I've been thinking either.
Ah, you'll have to do that.
I wouldn't really.
So this is your lounge?
Yeah.
Dining room? Yep. Kitchen? Oh, good. And tell me this, would you want to go back to Sandhurst to live?
Nah.
Nah. Is it? It's better here. Are the staff good?
Yeah.
Or are they no good?
They're all right.
They're all right? And is it loud here or quiet?
It's quiet.
It's quiet. Do you prefer it that way?
Yeah. One night, Spike ate Bicer Street, living in Bay Bicer Street, never find, go to the pokies on a Wednesday, and goes out to music on a Monday, and goes for a holiday with the amicus staff with Terry Tonkin when Shane preaches on Thursday. Then I like Liverpool, love Bicer Street very much, and thank Brett Eastwood and Sharon Stringer for getting Liverpool to live here Bicer Street.
What do you like about being here other than at Sandhurst Centre?
Because I like it here, because more room.
More room, yeah. Yeah. Are the staff okay?
Yeah, it's all right.
Yeah? I heard that you use the ride-on lawnmower.
Yeah.
Yourself?
Yep.
Really?
Yep.
Do you like this house?
Yeah, I do.
What's it like compared to your old place?
Good.
Good? What's better about it than Sandhurst Centre?
Sandhurst Centre?
Yeah.
Sandhurst Centre, no. I'm glad I'm living here, not Sandhurst Centre.
Yeah, just talk into the mic and say
certain words.
Yeah, just whatever you'd like to say about your new house.
New house, not a good time. New house, not a good time. My new unit, good time. That's all I want to say. That's it. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, they're here. Well, I've got to for you to say to you. About the closing of Sandhurst, that was pretty sad. And that's the closing of Sandhurst was very sad and all that, ladies and gentlemen. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to talk to you about new houses. We have, I got a new house joining me. I have a movie group down in my shed down and all. Singing rock and roll and all the stuff there 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 and joining up again a new rock and roll shit and all the stuff there and sorry that's all. Next person again.
See, it's a loon holder throat. Railing Wilson. Nanny Railing and Joseph.
I'll just say very quickly, in the process of the closure, as much as possible, everybody got to be a part of the planning and also choose some of the things they liked and what they'd want in their home. So a lot of these guys talked about their sheds and it was a really important thing where they've got, like, some people live in their own unit on their own. Others are in houses where there might be 2, 3, 4 other people. But a lot of people have got their own spaces, so like a shed where they can pull cars up or apart or do them up. Terry was referring to his shed where he can set up his music studio. So a lot of the planning, a lot of work to really get this tailored to what these guys all want. Okay.
Over the years of Sandhurst closing, that's all. Jenny Fish come in the other day to close the place, Sandhurst and all the business. And we got interested in closing Sandhurst ourselves. We're a bad place of people. We sit on top of ourselves and all the stuff there.
Can I just say, Terry, about 6 years ago, remember a conversation we had?
Yes.
And you talked about what you wanted to do in your new life.
Yes.
You wanted your own space, you wanted your privacy.
Yes.
And you wanted quiet.
Yes.
You got a nice quiet house now?
Yeah, bigger house.
Good on you, mate. That's terrific. I'd like you to put your hands together and thank the guys.
Yes.
There's just, hang on, stop. There's just one thing that I can't believe, that this guy here, he says he's got nothing to say. That's I've never known that to be the... Mark, come up here. Come here, Mark. Come here. Mark, come here. Now, hey, Mark, come here. Listen. Come here, over here, closer. Come here. Mark, how's your new house?
Good.
Oh, come up closer. Come up closer. Is it better than living at Sandhurst?
Yep.
Why?
You wait, Peter. Good.
Yeah, much nicer.
Yep.
Yeah, good food. You do the cooking?
Yep.
Oh, yuck.
Hi.
When are you going to invite me around for tea?
One day,
yeah, that's what they all say.
Sure, go,
on behalf of Valid and Having a Say Conference, I'd like to thank you guys from Sandhurst. I've got some presents here. I don't care what team you bag for, but if you come to Geelong, you have to bag for the Cats when you're in Geelong. So I've got some gifts here from the Cats Football Club, and we'll give these out backstage, okay? Sure, thank you very much, guys.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, Terry.
I want to do a song.
Not now.
Later.
Can you pick out the ones that they'd like from there?
Okay? Later,
at the back.
Later.
Thanks very much, later. Guys.
Can I do a song later, can I?
No, you're not doing a song now. No. That was very fun.
Later.
We'll see later, okay? We'll see later. Terry is a great Elvis fan. Right. There's something I was going to say. What was it? Oh, I just wanted to say something. That video we just saw there, it just reminds me of what incredibly talented staff we have. That video was put together by one of our staff members who is our advocacy coordinator. You hear, Don? Hey, what a star he is, hey? And Dom has been providing individual advocacy support to all those guys up there over the last several years. So, thank you for all of that. I also just want to make a comment about Jenny as a staff member. There's a tendency in advocacy to view staff and service providers as sometimes as the enemy, as the people you have to sort of change their minds, etc. That's never been Valid's experience. We find comrades, heroes in services every day. Staff who are working tirelessly to make a difference in people's lives. And when we first went up to Sandhurst, I have to tell you, I was feeling a bit nervous. Are the staff going to see us as trying to change their jobs, do them out of jobs, etc.? We found people like Jenny who were just champing at the bit to support people to have new lives. And I just want to put your hands together for Jenny. And also for the previous Jenny Cush from Stockton. She would never worked at Stockton, but she was a staff member who's done an awful lot. So thank you.